You're listening to the Bible teaching ministry of Pastor Ross Graham of Grace Bible Church, Kingswood, New South Wales, Australia. Ross will be using the inerrant Word of God to draw our truths in its original context. To find more messages like this, visit www.gracebiblechurchkingswood.org, or to join our online community, you can now find us on Facebook by searching for Grace Bible Church Kingswood. May this message today bless you, and as always, bring glory to God. Here's Pastor Ross.
Good morning and welcome to our service this morning. It is really good to see so many people out. A little bit disappointed, I must say, that some are not yet worshipping because of various reasons, but look, I think we need to get beyond being overly fearful of things with the way things are. But anyway, look, we're going to begin our service this morning with the singing of a song.
Thank you.
Take your Bibles, if you would, and turn to the passage that was read to us a little earlier in the service. And for those of you who will be tuning in later today on the internet, the passage is Luke 11, verses 37 through to the end of 41, which will be the passage of scripture that we will be dealing with in the course of this particular message. We are continuing to work through our series on the Gospel of Luke, and I know that many of you have been challenged, and many of you have been challenged to think and even stretch your thinking a little, as some of the things that we have looked at have come out of the precious page of Scripture. But as you sit in this church this morning, I wonder whether you remember getting your first car. Can you remember getting your first car? Hand up all of those who can remember getting that very first car. Look at those hands going up all over the church this morning. It may not have been a luxury model, fresh off the assembly line, but in your eyes it was really great, that first car of yours. I remember my car very, very well. It was a two-tone green 1956 F.E. Holden. It had chrome wheel nuts and chrome domes over the axle hubs, and also it had bullet hole transfers on the back window, which made it quite unique. Wherever I went, people recognized the fact and had to tell them that I wasn't a criminal being shot at. But nonetheless, let me say to you that that car had personality. The horn was really loud. The passenger side floor let water in. We must have had a small rust hole somewhere, and I can remember in my courting days with my dear wife now of 52 years, we would put newspapers underneath the mats to soak up the water so that she wouldn't have to drive on wet days with her feet up on the dashboard. It was kind of like an early or a late session of Noah's Ark. But I have to say this to you, the engine panted like a puppy, waiting for like a dog for a biscuit. And for cat lovers, I'd have to say it purred like a kitten. And if you were like me, you loved that car. And that's why you worried when you heard a strange yelp coming from underneath the bonnet, from underneath the hood. Clatter, clatter, clang, clang, rattle, rattle, rattle. Oh boy, what to do. What shall we do? Take the car to the car wash. That's what it needs. It needs a good lather and polish, and that'll make it run like new. And you found out that that didn't work. Didn't help at all. Buy a new radio. Some tunes will make it feel better, or at least drown out the rattle and all of the clunks that are going on, and you found out that that didn't work. Well, how about this one? Drive it harder. Rev up the engine as fast as it will go, and maybe it will fix itself. Don't think so. There's only one way to fix an engine. You have to open the bonnet or open the hood, reach deep into the greasy snarl of wires and metal, and repair the damaged parts. Internal problems require internal solutions. And church, you don't have to be a rocket scientist to work it out. It's a simple principle, but one we sometimes ignore when it comes to fixing our own hearts. We feel guilty. So what we do is we apply some shine to our appearance to give more money and give more money to charities or get more involved in the community around us. Depressing thoughts clatter in on our heads, so we buy new toys and new things and new cars and new homes and new clothes to make us feel better just for a moment. anger bangs and rattles inside. And so we drive ourselves harder and harder, hoping the noise will just go away. But it doesn't go away. Damaged hearts require spiritual repairs. And simply polishing the exterior of our lives with religion, let me say to you here this morning, just isn't really enough. So let me give you two distinctions we must always remember. When Christ offers us spiritually, what Christ offers us spiritually differs distinctly from what religion offers in at least two waves or two areas of life. For centuries within the church, ceremonial symbols have represented the actual realities of life in the person of Christ. And a problem occurs, however, when the symbols themselves overshadow what they represent. That happens in so many churches. The symbols that portray and talk of the person of Christ overshadow what they represent themselves. In communion, for example, we eat the bread and we drink the cup to express our trust in the Savior and remember Him who redeemed us upon the cross, who went to the cross in our place and who bore our sins. We partake of the Lord's Supper to remember that. However, the bread and the juice in themselves provide no spiritual nourishment apart from faith in Christ. They are only symbols. The reality is Christ's redemption, the work of the cross. That's what we remember. If you were traveling and someone asked you, happened to ask you to see your family, you'd probably show a snapshot, wouldn't you? If you had a picture, you'd pull it out and you'd show it to them. Yet that's only a glossy slip of paper. It's not your family. And in the same way, by way of example, the Lord's table is only a picture of what Christ did for us, not our actual salvation. And the truth of the matter is, Christ wants us to focus on what the symbols really mean. While religion would only have us dutifully and correctly serve the symbolic, or observe rather, the symbolic ceremonies. Similarly, religion often promotes external washing, while Christ insists on internal cleansing. You see, it's one thing to polish up our appearances by scrupulously conforming to a strict set of do's and don'ts and whatever the case may be. It's another thing entirely, let me suggest to you, to open our hearts to the Spirit of God and invite Him to change us from within, to invite the Spirit of God to change us and transform us from within. Inner cleansing means saying, Lord, here is all the dirt in my life. My pride, my greed, my lust, my manipulative ways in order to get people to do things. Forgive me, Lord. Heal me. Make me new. Now listen carefully. Pharisees, modern and ancient, unfortunately, never understand this distinction. They scrub and they scour their lives with the Ajax pad of religious duty until not one single solitary speck of grime remains. And on the outside, they sparkle. They sparkle like stars twinkling in the sky, but on the inside, they are full of filth. Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, who happens, by the way, let me point this out to you again, who happens to be God manifest in the flesh, Jesus confronted the Pharisees on his day on both issues. And he confronted the religious leaders and the Pharisees of his day because they continually, you see, substituted ceremonial symbols for spiritual reality and external washing for internal cleansing. In Jesus' mind, you see, it was time to peel away their varnished exterior and expose the rottenness that was underneath. So I want us to look today at how Jesus addressed both issues. And an opportune moment came when a Pharisee invited Jesus to come to his home. And we pick the account up in the 11th verse of the 37th verse rather of chapter 11. Follow along in your copy of God's inerrant word. And the scripture says this: when Jesus had finished speaking, a Pharisee invited him to eat with him. So he went in and reclined at the table. Now, why would a Pharisee invite Jesus over for a bite to eat? To enjoy the pleasure of Jesus' company? To share the riches of Scripture together? To talk privately about some concern in his walk with God, in his Pharisaical walk with God? Let me suggest to you, most likely not. And I say that because if you look ahead to verse 45 in the passage, you'll find that a group of specialists or experts in the law were there also. So, from the moment that Jesus stepped into the house, the hungry eyes of the religious leaders were sizing up everything that he said and everything that he did. They were looking for an opportunity to nail Jesus to the wall. And he had been invited to lunch, all right, no doubt about that whatsoever, but he was invited as the main course. And obviously Jesus knew this. And he knew exactly how to give the Pharisees a memorable case of indigestion. In fact, he's already done it when he reclined at the table. Did you notice that? The Pharisee, let me say, certainly noticed it. Look what it says there in the 38th verse of the passage in front of you. It says, but the Pharisee, noticing that Jesus did not first wash before the meal, was surprised. Gulp, indigestion. When everybody else was lining up at the basin, Jesus had squeezed past and seated himself. That seems a bit rude, doesn't it? Why didn't Jesus wash his hands before he ate? Well, he was using this opportunity to teach them something. And drawing on Jewish tradition and Jewish history, one biblical historian sets a place for us at this unusual banquet and helps us understand the issue here. I quote, and I've shared this with you before, but just listen again because I think it really drives home the point that Jesus was making here in this portion of Scripture. Listen to what this says. This hand washing was not in the interests of hygienic purity. It was ceremonial cleanness which was at stake. Before every meal and between each of the courses, the hands had to be washed. This was Jewish tradition, and they had to be washed in a certain way. The hands, to begin with, had to be free of any coating of sand or mortar or gravel or any such substance. The water for washing had to be kept in special large stone jars so that it itself was clean in the ceremonial sense, and so that it might be certain that it had been used for no other purpose and that nothing had fallen into it or had been mixed with it. First, the hands were held with the fingertips pointing upwards. water was poured over them and had to run at least down to the wrist. The minimum amount of water was 1/4 of a log, which is equal to 1.5 eggshells full of water. While the hands were still wet, each hand had to be cleansed with the fist of the other. At this stage, the hands were wet with water, but that water was now unclean because it had touched unclean hands. So next, the hands had to be held with fingertips pointing downwards, and the water had to be poured over them in such a way that it began at the wrist and ran off at the fingertips. After all that had been done, the hands were clean. To fail to do this was, in Jewish eyes, not to be guilty of bad manners, not to be dirty in the health sense, but to be unclean in the sight of God. If you want me to comment on that, I'll simply say, give me a break, Jake. You see, the Pharisees truly believed they could rinse away the day's defilement by ceremonially washing their hands. Which raises the question, where did they get this piece of information from? Where did they get such a notion? Well, Mark chapter 7 verse 3 tells us that these laws came from the tradition of the elders. You see, centuries earlier, church, pious men took upon themselves to help others by further defining the law's grand principles. And over time, these additional laws were etched in stone alongside of God's commandments, with thousands and thousands more, until the fine print marred the spirit of the law. And into the scene, into the dining table, comes Jesus. And by rejecting this single man-made ceremony, Jesus smashed their clay tablets right in front of their eyes. It was the only way he could teach them that sin is an inner problem requiring an inner solution. It's a matter of the heart. It's not a matter of the hands. And in verse 39 and 40, we read these words, "Then the Lord said to him, 'Now then, you Pharisees, clean the outside of the cup and dish, but inside you are full of greed and wickedness. You foolish people. Did not the one who made the outside make the inside also?'" You see, they washed the outside of the cup, the part that man could see, the show part of it all, but left the inside dirty and encrusted with mold and with corruption. If only they would cleanse the inside, they would not have to worry about the outside. And the truth is, and you need to understand this, and I think you will understand it well, that clean dishes and clean hands do not equal clean lives. We can't hide a dirty heart under a layer of ceremonies and religion, but God knows us inside out. He knows what's deep down inside our heart of hearts. And according to Jesus, the Lord of glory, cleansing from inside out is the only way that we can be pure. In contrast to the reams of rules the Pharisees had for achieving cleanness, Jesus, in the precious word of God, had only one instruction, and we find that in the 41st verse of the passage. If you'll follow along, he says there, "But give what is inside the dish to the poor, and everything will be clean for you." It's a reference to giving to the poor. And Jesus is saying here, this is what he's trying to teach these religious leaders who placed a lot of emphasis on the external rather than the internal. He's saying that giving to the poor is not for show, but it's an expression of a faithful heart. It's all about one's attitude before God. And that's what counts. You can have all of the ritual, all of the outward signs, all of the externals, but your attitude can be wrong towards God. It needs to be right. Love, Jesus said, is the sign of a pure heart. Remember his parable of the Good Samaritan? Who stopped and cared for the wounded man while the sanctimonious priests and Levi skirted by? In the story, in this particular story, as well as in real life, it's easy to tell whose heart is clean by the love shining through a person's life. And I don't need to remind you that Jesus said, "By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another." And we sit in our pews here today and we marvel at the Pharisees trying to atone for their sins by simply washing their hands. Yet are we much different? Are we much different? Wanting to look holy, we pour water over our lives as we perform our Sunday morning routines, and I'm speaking figuratively there. We try our best to hold our hands properly, to say just the right words, to wear the right clothes, to do the right things. Why us lose our tempers? Lust, slander, promise to do things and don't do it, envy, never. Not us. How could you say such a thing when our Christian smiles are so bright? Church, let me just say this to you. Christ, however, isn't fooled by our appearance. He wants us to stop pretending and start caring about having a clean heart in every aspect of our lives. Two principles from his lesson can help us avoid the religious hypocrisy of the Pharisees. First, don't think by cleaning up the outward appearances of your life that it covers up the wrong within. Don't think by cleaning up the outward appearances of your life that it covers up the wrong within. You see, just as we can't fix an engine by washing the car, so we can't fix our sinfulness by sprinkling some religion over the surface of our lives, thinking that it's somehow a miraculous, magical dust. You need to understand me. I wouldn't give you 2 red cents for religion. Belongs to the devil. What we need is a relationship with Christ. And to feel truly clean, we must invite Christ into our inner chambers. Every chamber of our life. The bathroom, the bedroom, the kitchen, the lounge room. Secondly, it's vitally important to give close attention to the inside of your life. It's vitally important to give close attention to the inside of your life. Living in a cosmetic world, we have at our fingertips everything we could ever need to look better than we are. But God sees, listen, it's a fitting illustration actually. I just thought of it. God sees behind your masks. He sees behind your masks. The writer of the Hebrews says in Hebrews 4:13, nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give an account. Don't be afraid to lay your life bare before God. Because the truth of the matter is, he knows all about the dirt. He knows all about the scandal. He knows all about the little heaps of dust, little piles of dust, as it were, that you've been sweeping under the rug, all of the little hidden motives and the contrivings that you have. And he won't be shocked. God is not up in heaven sitting on his throne going, oh! He knows. He wants to give you the wonderful feeling of being clean from the inside out. So friends, don't be like the Pharisees who tried to cover themselves with the thick bark of religion. Allow Christ, the Lord of glory, to peel away all the pretenses and heal the disease that's rotting us inside. And let him do that through his marvelous, matchless grace. I don't know the condition of every heart who sits in this church this morning. I don't know the condition of every soul that's watching on the internet. But if you have never come to a place in your life where you have realized that you are a sinner and that you're filthy inside and you need cleansing from inside out, you must of necessity come to the cross. You must of necessity come to the person of the cross, the Lord Jesus, who died in your place, who took your punishment, who took your hell. And when you bow before the Lord, admitting that you are a sinner, that you have offended a holy God, you will receive eternal life. And I'll give you the opportunity right now to bow right where you are, where you're looking, and to pray this prayer that I'll pray in the first person, and you can give the amen at the end. Let's bow. Dear God, we want to thank you here for loving me. I confess today that I have sinned against you. So please forgive my sin. I believe that your Son, Jesus Christ, died on the cross in my place to pay for my sin. But not only that, Lord, he rose again from the dead. Set spirits free. And I confess Jesus this day as my Lord and Savior, and I receive your gift of eternal life. Amen, amen and amen. I want you really to enjoy our closing song.
Back to the place where I used to go. Today I saw that same old crowd I knew before. When they asked me what had happened, I tried to tell them. I don't come here anymore. Thanks to Calvary, I am not the man I used to be. Thanks to Calvary, things are different than before. Tears ran down my face. I tried to tell them,
thanks to God.
Calvary.
I don't come here anymore. Then we went back to the house where we used to live. My little boy ran and hid behind the door. I said, son, don't be afraid. You've got a brand new daddy now.
Thanks to Calvary.
We don't live here anymore.
Thanks to Calvary.
I am not the dad I used to be. Tried to tell him,
thanks to Calvary,
we don't live here anymore.
Thanks to Calvary,
we don't live here anymore.
Thank you for tuning in to Pastor Ross Graham. And for more information about his ministry, visit www.gracebiblechurchkingswood.org. Until next time, God bless.